What is up, my Johnnies and Jennies? It's Shannon from the Trinisphere, where Timmy, Johnny, and Spike battle for all things EDH. Today, we're going to be battling over Budget Brews, and I have for my submission five color planeswalkers. That's right, the co-host challenged me to build a sub-$50 Super Friends list, and I said, you know what? Why not make it five color while we're at it? Before we dive into the deck list, help out the channel by liking, subscribing, and hitting the bell icon. You'll get notifications when the value-centric Oketra list by Hog the Spike and the aggressive beatdown Grimgrin list by Juan the Timmy come out later, as well as the gameplay using all of these lists drops next week. Alright, so as you can imagine, playing five-color planeswalkers is going to require some supreme jank. So at the helm of our five-color planeswalkers, we're going to be running Sisay Weatherlight Captain, the 3-mana 2-2 legendary human soldier that gets a +1/+1 for each color among other legendary permanents we control. You can play Wubberg to search your library for a legendary permanent card with CMC less than Sisay's power and put that card on the battlefield and then shuffle your library. So we effectively have a 50-cent commander that is a tutor engine that can go fetch up any planeswalker we want and put it in the battlefield, so long as its CMC is less than her power. She also is on average a 7-7 once we got all five color worth of planeswalkers in play, because remember, planeswalkers are legendary permanents. So that covers our five color requirement pretty nicely, but how is a deck filled with mediocre War of the Spark planeswalkers who don't have ultimates, who only roll down, and don't produce enough power to overwhelm opponents, and how are we going to win with this kind of list? Well, the best way to do so is to overwhelm our opponents with as many planeswalkers as fast as possible, and that's almost always the case with Super Friends. So the main method we're going to be winning with this deck is through the use of Primal Surge. This 10-mana sorcery says exile a top card of your library. If it's a permanent card, you may put that onto the battlefield, and if you do, repeat this process. So basically, we can play cards off the top of our deck until we hit an instant or a sorcery. Can you guess how many instants and sorceries are in this list? You are correct. There are no other instants and sorceries in this list other than Primal Surge. That means when we cast Primal Surge, we can play the entire library onto the battlefield and then go from there. So once we have all of our planeswalkers in play off of a Primal Surge, all 24 of them, how do we immediately end the game and not just get blown out by some kind of sweeper? We use Sarkhan the Masterless, the 5-mana 5 loyalty planeswalker that has a +1 that says until end of turn, each planeswalker you control becomes a 4-4 red dragon creature and gains flying. He can also, for -3, make a 4-4 dragon creature token with flying, and he also has a static ability that does damage to attackers equal to the number of dragons we control. So Sarkhan the Masterless can animate all 24 of our planeswalkers into 4-4 flying creatures. We can use that in conjunction with Samut Tyrant Smasher, the 4-mana 5 loyalty planeswalker that says, creatures you control have haste, and for -1 loyalty, target creature gets +2/+1 and gains haste until end of turn and scry 1. So once both of these are in the battlefield, we can turn all of our planeswalkers into 4-4 flying, hasting dragon. That means we have 96 power on board after we resolve Primal Surge and before we go to combat. For extra redundancy, so that we can acquire Primal Surge consistently, we're going to run Wishclaw Talisman, the 2-mana artifact that says it enters with 3 wish counters on it, and for 1 in tap and removing of a wish counter, we may search our library for a card, put it into our hand, and then shuffle our library. Then an opponent gains control of Wishclaw Talisman, but players can only activate this ability during their own turn. So if we plan on getting Primal Surge and winning this turn, it doesn't matter if we give this to one of our opponents, we're just going to end up killing them with dragons anyways. Even if we decide to be benevolent and let the person to whom we've given Wishclaw Talisman survive, we're going to be hitting a lot of other artifact removal staple to creatures and enchantments as we're Primal Surging. We'll be able to blow up this Wishclaw Talisman before they ever get a chance to use it. We're also going to use Possibility Storm, the 5-mana enchantment that says whenever a player casts a spell from their hand, that player exiles it, then exiles cards from the top of their library until they exile a card that shares a type with it. That player may cast a card without paying its mana cost, then they put all cards exiled with Possibility Storm on the bottom of their library in a random order. So this card says whenever you cast an instant, you instead start exiling cards until you find a different instant, and you cast that second instant instead of the first one. It's kind of like a whenever you cast an instant, cascade into a different instant. Now we use this in conjunction with the new mechanic, Adventure. So Adventure is always stapled to a creature, and in all zones except for the stack, those cards are creatures. However, when they're on the stack, they are the Adventure type. For example, Beanstalk Giant is a 7-mana creature that has power and toughness equal to the number of lands we control. However, it does have an adventure called Fertile Footsteps. For 3-mana, you get to cast a sorcery, which searches your library for a basic land and puts it on the battlefield and then shuffles your library. So when you cast this as a sorcery, it triggers Possibility Storm to cascade into the next sorcery in your deck. And like we said before, there are no other instants and sorceries in this list. So when you cast Beanstalk Giant's Fertile Footsteps adventure, you hit Primal Surge 100% of the time. This means Possibility Storm not only gives us an avenue to reach Primal Surge through any sorcery-based based adventures. Possibility Storm also gives us protection. Once we've resolved our entire library, it disrupts people's ability to cast instants. If they try and target Samut, Tyrant Smasher, in order to disrupt our haste, they have to then cascade their instant removal spell into a different instant removal spell, not a counter spell, not a draw spell, and then use that on Tyrant Smasher. So that gives us an extra layer of protection. So Primal Surge is a 10 mana spell, which is pretty egregious. Feeling quite Timmy today. So we're gonna use a ton of ramp in order to reach that 10 mana. We're gonna use Beanstalk Giant, like we mentioned before, Channeler Initiate, Darksteel Ingot, and Elvish Rejuvenator. And I really like Elvish Rejuvenator in this list because I'm gonna be running a lot of bounce lands. Those lands like Azorius Chancery that return a land to our hand. So being able to get a second land drop off of Elvish Rejuvenator, putting that into play tapped and bouncing an extra land is just a solid way to effectively draw a card and ramp fast. We're gonna be running Fabro Elder, Firemind's Vessel, Leyline Prowler, and Paradise Druid. And Fabro Elder is a fantastic card. At $1.19, pick these things up, man. They're great. This 3-mana Vigilant 0/0 gets a +1/+1 for each color of permanence we control. So right when it comes into play, it's a 2/2, but very often it's closer to a 5/5. It can also tap, and for each color of permanence we control, add a mana of that color. So once we have all 5 colors in play, this taps for Wubberg, 5 mana. That makes casting Primal Surge a lot easier when you have 5 mana coming out of one creature. Also, being a Vigilant 5/5 means it's great at defending our Planeswalkers and being aggressive towards opponents. We're also going to run Quirion Explorer, Ral Zarek, Rosethorn Acolyte, and Sphere of the Suns. Rosethorn Acolyte's another one of those adventure cards. This 3-mana 2/3 taps for any color and has a adventure called Seasonal Ritual. For a single green, we can cast a sorcery that adds 1 mana of any color to our mana pool. Helps us fix early, helps us Possibility Storm into our Primal Surge. And then to round out the list, we're gonna have Spring Bloom Druid and Silvok Explorer. So you can see we have a good, decent chunk of ramp, and we have a lot of pieces in here that are good at defending Planeswalkers, either after they've done their ramping or because they have Dead Touch or are aggressive bodies. On to our removal. Of course, we're gonna wanna last as long as possible in this game, so we're gonna have a pile of removal. For targeted removal, we've got Giant Killer, Gideon Jura, Hypnotic Sprite, and Kaya. Bane of the Dead. Hypnotic Sprite is our only counterspell. This 2-mana 2/1 flyer can go on an adventure called Mesmeric Glare. For 3 mana at instant speed, we can counter a spell that costs 3 CMC or less. Now we can try and use this to cover our Primal Surge, but it's quite difficult to have 13 mana available at any time. But we can also use this to disrupt opponents because that is a conditional hard counterspell. We're also gonna run Nahiri Storm of Stone, Oath of Kaya, Obnixilus Reignited, and Obnixilus the Hate Twisted. The pair of Obnixilai are quite great in this deck. The first one, Reignited, being a 5-mana 5 loyalty with +1 draw card, lose a life, -3 destroy a target creature, and then has an ult that says -8, giving an opponent an emblem that says whenever an opponent draws a card, you lose 2 life. So this guy is great at just controlling the board, controlling the flow of the game, removing creatures, and drawing us, because we need to dig as deep as we can, as fast as we can, to hit Primal Surge. Obnixilus the Hate Twisted does the same kind of work. He staples his draw and removal into one ability. So for 5-mana 5 loyalty, he has a static ability that says whenever an opponent draws a card, Obnixilus the Hate Twisted deals 1 damage to that player, and then for -2, destroy a target creature, and his controller draws 2 cards. So we can effectively use this as a skull clamp on our own tokens. Whenever we generate tokens from our various creatures, we can just -2 Omnixilus to draw 2 cards. And to round out the list, we're gonna have Overseer the Damned, Ravenous Chupacabra, and the Wanderer. The Wanderer is kind of a techie piece in here too, because of course you can search it at instant speed with Cissei, which can save us from infinite damage spells. So if somebody is going off, they have infinite mana, and they choose to blast us with a Comet Storm, we can activate Cissei and put the Wanderer into play, and now we prevent all damage to be dealt to us and permanents we control. Moving on to our non-creature removal, we have Embereth Shieldbreaker, Meteor Golem, Reclamation Sage, and Seal of Primordium. So Embereth Shieldbreaker, another sorcery speed adventurer. This 2-mana 2/1 can go on the adventure battle display for a single red sorcery. We can destroy target artifact, so useful early game, useful late game to trigger our Possibility Storm to hit Primal Surge. And then we're gonna round out our non-creature removal with also Vraska the Unseen, the 5-mana 5 loyalty planeswalker that has +1 until our next turn, creatures that deal damage to Vraska are destroyed, and then for -3, destroy target non-land permanent. It also has a -7 to make 3 assassins that if they hit a player, that player loses the game, but not quite as relevant as our -3, capable of dealing with our non-traditional threats in the form of enchantments and artifacts. For sweepers, we still got sweepers in here because we're a planeswalker deck, and planeswalker decks love sweepers. We're gonna be running Massacre Girl, Phyrexian Scriptures, and Sunblast Angel. Massacre Girl is awesome in this deck, a 5-mana 4/4 menace, 55 cents. Come on, that's just great. Massacre Girl enters the battlefield, each other creature gets a -1/-1 until end of turn, and then whenever a creature dies this turn, each other creature gets a -1/-1 again. So Massacre Girl completely wipes the board so long as you have a 1/1 and then maybe some 2/2s, any number of 1/1s and some number of 2/2s, and at that point it doesn't even matter, everything's dying. Massacre Girl is also very good because she is a legendary creature, so that means we can tutor her up with CC and put her into play at instant speed. So no better way to end somebody's token-based turn than blowing everyone out and clearing the board. Fraction of Scriptures is a 4-mana saga with 3 chapters. The first one puts a +1/+1 counter on target creature and turns it into an artifact. The second one destroys all non-artifact creatures, and the third one exiles all cards from all opponents' graveyards. The most important one here is the second chapter, destroying all non-artifact creatures. The first one's not quite as relevant. Saving one of our creatures is fine, but not really important since we're a planeswalker deck. So getting to chapter 2 is very relevant, and you can actually proliferate your sagas in order to trigger chapters quickly. Sunblast Angel destroys all tapped creatures, so combos really well with Gideon, Jura, when you force them to attack us, and then you use Sunblast Angel the following turn to kill everything that attacked us. For draw power, we have Ajani Unyielding, Chandra Fire Artisan, Dovin Bond, and Foulmire Knight. Ajani Unyielding is probably one of the most expensive cards in this deck at $2 whopping dollars. This 6-mana 4 loyalty planeswalker says +2, reveal the top 3 cards of your library and put all non-land permanents revealed this way into your hand and the rest in the bottom of your library in any order. So this deck has 1 non-permanent card and 37 lands. So there's 62 possible hits in this deck, which means when you +2 him, you're very often going to be drawing 2-3 cards. Easy. His -2 is awesome. Exile target creature, its controller gains life equal to its power. It's basically Swords to Plowshares as his -2. And then it has a -9 that puts 5 +1/+ counters on our creatures and 5 loyalty on our planeswalkers. So if you can ult this, he basically allows all the other planeswalkers to ult. Chandra Fire Artisan, a decent draw engine. Dovin Bond, control aspect with draw added in. And then Foulmire Knight, a 1-mana, 1/1 death toucher that can go on the adventure. Profane Insight, 3-mana instant speed, draw a card and lose a life. So this is basically a cantrip that makes a 1/1 death toucher that can defend our planeswalkers very well. Kazmina, Enigmatic Mentor, Kiora, Behemoth Beckoner, Merchant of the Veil, and Oath of Jace provide us additional draw. Kazmina is a great example of what to use in this deck. This 4-mana 5 loyalty planeswalker can -2 to create a 2/2 wizard and then draw and discard a card. So digs deep for our Primal Surge and creates blockers and stalls the game. Exactly what we want. She also has a static ability, spells your opponent's cast that target a creature or planeswalker you control costs 2 more to cast. QR Behemoth Beckoner draws a card whenever a creature with power 4 or greater enters a battlefield under control. There's not a lot of that in this deck, but that is our commander for one. Kiora is 2 different colors and is legendary, so if Kiora is in play and we cast our Cissei, she is already going to be a 4/4, not counting any other legendary permanents. So she'll draw us a card, as well as our Feyburrow Elder and our Beanstalk Giant. But more importantly, Kiora has -1 untapped target permanent. And like I mentioned before, we've been running a lot of bounce lands, so this is -1 untapped target bounce land, or -1 add 2 mana to our mana pool. So that helps us get to our 10 mana Primal Surge as best as we can. And then also I want to talk about Oath of Jace, the 3-mana legendary enchantment that says when it enters the battlefield, draw 3 and discard 2, and at the beginning of your upkeep, scry X, where X is the number of planeswalkers you control. This is one of my favorite oaths. In fact, this is one of the most often cards I tutor first because people, I think, undervalue and under threat assess this card. It's very often that you have a lot of mediocre planeswalkers in play. Maybe they already rolled down and they're just sitting around generating a static ability from their War of the Planeswalker stat line. So this card ends up allowing you to scry 3, 4, 5 extra cards every turn, digging for your Primal Surge. And then we're gonna round the list with a Sunbird's Invocation, a 6-mana enchantment that says whenever you cast a spell from your hand, reveal the top X cards of your library, where X is the spell's CMC, then you may cast a card revealed this way with CMC X or less without paying its cost, and then put the rest in the bottom of your library in a random order. So this basically is a wild pair for your planeswalkers. You cast a 4-drop planeswalker, you reveal the top 4 cards, oh, another 4-drop planeswalker, excellent. So now they're all basically cloning themselves. This is one of those cards that can generate threats at an accelerated rate, maybe allowing you to overwhelm your opponents with different planeswalkers. For defense of our planeswalkers, we're going to be running Arlen, Voice of the Pack, Dovin, Hand of Control, Oath of Gideon, and Oath of Liliana. Oath of Liliana is another one of my favorite oaths. This 3-mana legendary enchantment says when it enters the battlefield, each opponent sacrifices a creature. So I like using this on turn 3 on curve in order to punish everyone who ramped in their commander quickly. Then of course it has the other ability. At the beginning of each end step, if a planeswalker enters the battlefield under your control, put a 2/2 black zombie creature into play. So that means every time you cast a planeswalker, it comes with a little defender, a little guardian. Similarly, Saheeli Sublime Artificer, Tybalt Arrakish Instigator, and Vraska Swarm's Eminence are another series of token generators able to create blockers, Saheeli being the best of them all. She's a 3-mana 5 loyalty walker that says whenever we cast a non-creature spell, aka a planeswalker, we create a 1/1 servo. Every single planeswalker we cast comes with a 1/1 servo guarding it. For -2, it turns one of our artifacts into an artifact or a different artifact or creature we control. Not as relevant, but we can always turn one of our servos into a second Feyburrow Elder, and then what do you know, you have 10 mana across 2 creatures, able to cast Primal Surge and maybe keep your Hypnotic Sprite counter mana open. Once we have all 24 planeswalkers in play, we have 96 power on board, but we can push that a little further and make sure that we get all all that damage through and kill as many people as possible through some buffing planeswalkers. Ajani the Greathearted, Angrath, Captain of Chaos, and Domri, Anarch of Bolas, along with Oath of Ajani. So Ajani the Greathearted, the 4-mana 5 level T planeswalker, gives all our creatures vigilance. Not that relevant when we're attacking with our dragons, because who cares if we give our planeswalkers vigilance? They're not going to be creatures on our opponent's turn, so they won't be able to block. However, he has a +1 that gains us 3 life and a -2, most importantly, that adds a +1/+1 counter to each creature we control and a loyalty counter to each planeswalker we control. So his -2 effectively proliferates. It just pumps all of our creatures to be bigger if they already have counters. Even if they don't, it adds counters to them. And it increases our planeswalker's loyalty, which is very helpful since a lot of our planeswalkers are those War of the Spark planeswalkers that are stuck at 1 loyalty with no way to roll down because they're all mostly -2s. So he can give them that extra added oomph as well as pushing one to its ultimate easily. More importantly, Angrath, Captain of Chaos, the 4-mana 5 loyalty planeswalker, says creatures you control have menace. So that makes all of our 24 flying dragon planeswalkers pretty difficult to block. Even if they have flying blockers, they have 2-for-1s, and this is going to push to a ton of damage. He also has a -2 due to a mass 2, which creates that army token and puts 2 counters on it, or puts 2 counters on an existing army token. Domri, Anarch of Bolas, is one of the most powerful cards in this category. A 3-mana 3 loyalty planeswalker says creatures you control get +1/+0. So this is like an Orcish Aura Flame. It turns all of our flying planeswalkers into 5/4s instead of 4/4s. That makes math a lot easier. And then he has a +1 that adds a red or a green to our mana pool, and creature spells we cast this turn can't be countered. And then he has a -2 that says target creature control fights target creature you don't control. So the +1 gets to our Primal Surge faster, a turn earlier, so he's a ramp engine. His -2 allows Cissé to become a removal spell, because Cissé is on average going to be like a 7-power creature, so it's going to be easy for her to fight and pop off other opposing creatures. And then finally we have Oath of Ajani, which gets a +1/+1 counter on all creatures we control. So this is useful, although it's not entirely busted. When we Primal Surge, this is definitely going to come into play, and it's definitely going to trigger and put +1/+1 counters on our creatures. But almost always when we Primal Surge, we're also going to be hitting Massacre Girl at the same time, which is going to wipe the entire board of all blockers, because we're going to rely entirely on our planeswalkers to deal the lethal damage. So this is more techie for earlier game, not as useful when we hit it off of Primal Surge, but it also says planeswalker spells we cast cost 1 less to cast. So this is very useful when we're using Sunbreeze Invocation to ramp out as many planeswalkers as we can without Primal Surge. To round out our list, we have some utility cards, including Evolution Sage, Flux Channeler, Nihil Spellbomb, and Oath of Teferi. The first two are our proliferate engines. Evolution Sage is a 3-mana 3/2 elf druid that says whenever a land enters the battlefield under control, proliferate. And Flux Channeler is a 3-mana 2/2 that says whenever we cast a non-creature spell, proliferate. So Flux Channeler works especially well with Sunbreeze Invocation again, because Sunbreeze Invocation casts the second planeswalker, the one that you reveal from its ability. So you basically get 2 proliferate triggers with Flux Channel in play. Whenever you cast those, you get an extra loyalty for your planeswalkers. Evolution Sage is really good in this deck with Primal Surge, because when she's revealed off of Primal Surge, now all the subsequent lands that come into play trigger it and proliferate. So you're getting a ton of proliferate triggers on top of playing all of your planeswalkers out of your deck. A lot of them are just going to be ready to ultimate once your Primal Surge resolves. They're going to have a ton of loyalty. And then Nihil Spellbomb, useful for removing graveyards. You always want to have one of these in your deck. Oath of Teferi, one of the most powerful oaths of them all. This 5-mana legendary enchantment says, when it enters the battlefield, exile another target permanent you control and return it to the battlefield at the beginning of the next end step. And then you may activate the loyalty abilities of planeswalkers you control twice each turn, rather than only once. What? This is an always-on chain veil. So this is really good with a ton of planeswalkers, especially that one I mentioned before, Ajani Unyielding. Because you remember his +2 says reveal top 3 cards and put all non-land permanents into our hand, and his -2 says Swords to Plowshares. So with your Oath of Teferi, you can just use Ajani Unyielding to +2. Draw some cards, then -2, Swords to Plowshares, and he stays at the exact same loyalty as he began. You can do this every turn, just punishing your opponents. Draw cards, swords your creature, draw cards, swords your creature, over and over and over again. Also, one of the final adds to our list is Davio, Rogue Shadow Mage, the 3-mana 3 loyalty planeswalker that says at the beginning of each opponent's upkeep, if they have one or fewer cards in hand, deal 2 damage to them, and the -1 target player discards a card. He's kind of just in here to be a 4-4 flying beater when we use our Sarkhan the Master list, because the discard synergy is not very strong in this deck, because we're not hitting opponents with consistent amounts of discards. They're going to be able to discard something that's irrelevant to them. We're not going to be able to punish them and get to that meatier cards in their hand. And a quick look at our mana base. We're going to be using a lot of the tri-lands. For example, Crumbling Necropolis. The ones that come into play tap and generate 3 colors, because we're evenly spread across colors. I know a lot of people are going to say that's too slow. I don't want to play these tap lands, but it's very important that we have access to all of our colors. And then we're also going to be running the bounce lands. like Azorius Chancery I mentioned before. They come into play tap and then return a land to our hand, but they produce two mana of a specific combination of colors. The reason we run these is because I like to consider this two land drop staple to one card. This allows us to hit a lot of our land drops more consistently. For example, if you start a game with a basic land in your hand and an Azorius Chancery in your hand, you can go three turns, not two, three turns before you miss your first land drop. So you can play your basic on turn one, on turn two, play your Azorius Chancery and bounce for basic, then on turn three, replay that basic. So you have four opportunities to draw a third land before turn four in order to ensure that you hit your curve and don't miss any land drops. It's very important in this deck that we do not miss any land drops because we got to get to 10 mana consistently. So we're going to be running a lot of these bounce lands to ensure that we are always hitting our land drops. And we're also going to round it out with the usual suspects, including basics, Evolving Wilds, Tomb of Expanse, but another notable one is Interplanar Beacon. This land says, whenever you cast a Planeswalker, gain one life. It taps for colorless, and for one end tap, it can add two mana of different colors and spend that mana only to cast Planeswalker spells. So it can filter any generic mana into another mana color effectively. All right, guys, that's a wrap on this $50 budget, five color Super Friends list. Now, this deck is a ton of fun to play. It's very often threat assessed very lowly because you're running a lot of mediocre War of the Spark Planeswalkers that just generate some tokens here and there. Don't really impact the game that much. And then all of a sudden you Primal Surge when no one's looking, and they go from pummeling each other to dying to 120 flying damage. This deck is pretty consistent, and it's pretty good at defending itself and stalling out and ramping, which is all the things we want to see. If you enjoy this list, be sure to let me know. I enjoy brewing budget and on a challenge. It's the Johnny way. Give me some other ideas of different challenges you'd like to see me brew. Follow the link below to go to TCG Player if you want to buy any of the cards in this list. If you follow that affiliate link, that means we get a percentage of TCG Player's cut whenever you buy any cards. And that goes a long way to help out that channel, to keep the lights on, to keep our editing computer running, which has died twice now. This is Shannon the Johnny signing off. Great minds brew alike.